Political assassination was a common instrument of policy in the 16th century. Great rulers and European grandees alike stood in fear of plots to poison them. Mary, Queen of Scots, connived at the disposal of one politically and personally undesirable husband, and enthusiastically entertained plotters who hoped to eliminate her cousin, Queen Elizabeth. But Elizabeth herself had been tainted early in her reign with suspicion of involvement in a murder. A murder, moreover, which could not easily be dignified by the title of political assassination. A simple, vulgar, eternal triangle domestic murder, wherein an unwanted spouse was eliminated so that a pair of lovers could marry. And one of those lovers, so gossip all over Europe had it, was the Virgin Queen herself. The child Elizabeth had frequently played with a little boy of her own age. Robert Dudley was the fifth son of the great Earl of Warwick and Duke of Northumberland, the most powerful man in the kingdom at the end of Elizabeth's little brother Edward VI's reign. Indeed, for a very short time after that reign, Northumberland claimed to be the new queen's father-in-law, for he popped his eldest son, Sir Guildford Dudley, on the throne as consort to Sir Guildford's unfortunate wife, Lady Jane Grey, granddaughter of Henry VII. Claiming to maintain the Protestant succession in opposition to Edward's elder sister, the Catholic Mary, Northumberland and the Dudleys outraged English feeling in favour of a legitimate succession. Northumberland was executed and revealed his treacherous and power-seeking nature by declaring himself a secret Catholic on the scaffold. Before his father's downfall, Sir Robert Dudley had married an heiress. In 1549, a shoemaker called Robert Kett led local malcontents in a blockade of Norwich. The 19-year-old Robert Dudley led a force which successfully suppressed Kett's rising. Then, stopping at Sir John Robsart's castle of Siderstern in Norfolk, Dudley first set eyes on Sir John's daughter Amy, 1 year younger than himself. The meeting was an instant coup de foudre. He was young, gallant, handsome and swaggering. She was beautiful, elegant, superbly dressed at all times. They fancied each other madly, and Sir John had little hesitation in letting the arrogant young grandee marry his daughter. Who could doubt that Dudley would otherwise have seduced her? "Marriages of desire begin in happiness and end in enmity," commented shrewd old William Cecil. The young couple were married with great festivities when Edward VI held court at Sheen in 1550, and Sir John gave them Siderstern as their own residence. They were handsome and rich. Their only unhappiness was that Amy proved childless. Throughout Mary Tudor's short reign, Lord Robert Dudley, he'd acquired the courtesy title on his father's becoming a duke, and his childhood playmate, Princess Elizabeth, kept apart and kept very low profiles. Elizabeth was in perpetual danger, as the Protestants hoped she might become the rallying point of a rising against Bloody Mary's attempt to burn England back to Catholicism at the stake. Elizabeth kept her head in every sense, and refused to have anything to do with risings that promised her the crown, but endangered her life. Lord Robert Dudley was lucky to escape execution for having proclaimed Lady Jane Grey Queen near his home in King's Lynn. But Bloody Mary was not outrageously bloody where simple politics rather than religion were concerned. And the minor Dudleys seemed little danger. Across the country, they were reviled as arrogant, ambitious, treacherous people. Lord Robert's opportunity to rise in the world came when his old playmate, having been cautiously discreet, herself succeeded peacefully to the throne on the 17th of November, 1588. She and he were now 27 years old, and Lord Robert was summoned to court. He was made Master of the Horse. He was made a Knight of the Garter. His star was in the ascendant, for the Queen clearly favoured him personally. Amy said that her husband was sore troubled with weighty affairs. "This is Elizabethan for being kept late at the office." Lady Robert hardly ever saw her husband because he was given apartments at court and the Queen rarely let him out of her presence. Now, this was unpopular with the court and the country. Dudley's arrogance and ambition affronted the nobility.
"Lord Robert shall never die in his bed," said the Duke of Norfolk, "unless he gives over his preposterous pretensions."
Sir William Cecil was Elizabeth's principal adviser, and the statesman who, above all others, laid down the policies that would make her reign great. He threatened to resign before she had been 2 years on the throne if she continued to show Dudley so much favour. The Spanish ambassador wrote home, "Lord Robert is the worst young fellow I have ever encountered. He is heartless, spiritless, treacherous, and violent. Every day he presumes more and more, and it is now said that he means to divorce his wife." The common people had little doubt why Lord Robert would want to divorce Amy. Anne Dow of Brentford was imprisoned for saying the Queen had secretly borne him a child. Cecil told the Spanish ambassador he feared Dudley and the Queen were conspiring to poison Amy. And the ambassador reported home, "In Lord Robert it is easy to recognise the future king, but I am mistaken if the English will stand so crooked a business. There is not a man or woman who does not cry out on the Queen and on Lord Robert with disgust and indignation." Although Robin, as the Queen called him, seldom went home to Norfolk nowadays, the Queen took steps in 1560 to bring his home closer to the court. Her personal physician, Dr. Owen, was persuaded to give up his country house, Cumnor Hall, in Oxfordshire. It was a beautiful place, with lovely gardens and famous fish ponds. Amy, rich in her own right, moved there in some state with a full staff of servants. All loved her grace and kindness to them, and Amy loved the new house. But as comptroller of the household, her major domo or steward, she had to accept her husband's hanger-on, Anthony Forster. And Forster brought with him a very sinister figure called Verney, who was widely believed to carry out all the underhand and dirty work Dudley required. They were a dodgy lot altogether, these Elizabethan courtiers. Christopher Marlowe was stabbed through the eye and killed in a tavern brawl by one of them when he was establishing himself as a hanger-on of Sir Thomas Walsingham. William Shakespeare seems to have looked over the possibility of joining the Earl of Southampton's household and then thought better of it, creating Malvolio, Sir Toby Belch and Sir Andrew Aguecheek in recognition of the disreputability of such underlings. On the 8th of September, when she'd only been at Cumnor a couple of months, Amy sent her household off to enjoy themselves and perhaps purchase necessaries at Abingdon Fair. She had dinner privately with Mrs. Owen. She was in perfect health and reasonably good spirits. After dinner, when the servants came home from the fair, they found Amy lying at the foot of the great staircase of Cumnor Hall. Her neck was broken. Dudley was told the following day, as he was in attendance on the Queen at Windsor. He burst out with impassioned grief and horror, but also told those around him he was sure Amy had come to her death by foul play and he would be blamed. To everyone's surprise, he neglected to go to Cumnor and deal with the affair himself. He wrote to Amy's relatives in East Anglia, telling them the sad news. He wrote to his cousin, Thomas Blunt, asking him to go to Cumnor, select a coroner's jury of discreet and substantial men, and ascertain whether Amy died by evil chance or by villainy. And he wrote to Blunt's brother-in-law, Appleyard, asking him to go to Cumnor also and help at the inquest. And now something very odd happens to the record. All the papers recording the inquest were destroyed. All the letters between Dudley and Blunt and Appleyard, bar one, were destroyed. In the one surviving letter, Blunt describes staying at an inn in Abingdon, where he learned that the common folk were divided over the truth about Amy's death. He gives an account of the death, which communicates almost nothing, except that Forster was definitely around the house and seemed to be involved. It is clear, too, that the coroner's jury had disagreed, some definitely thinking Forster had killed Amy. Appleyard later admitted that he had attended the inquest and had covered her death for Leicester's sake. The Earl of Leicester was to be Robert Dudley's final title. Did Appleyard engineer a cover-up? Well, certainly both Dudley and the Queen subsequently showered him with favours. and there is no sign of any other service he rendered which would have deserved them. The scandal of Amy Robsart Dudley's death was of continental magnitude. Practically every foreign ambassador believed that Lord Robert had killed Lady Robert so as to be free to marry the Queen. All, without exception, thought that Dudley and the Queen certainly would now marry. All, without exception, thought this would be disgraceful. The French court believed that the pair had actually married in secret after Amy's death, and that that death had been caused by Amy's neck being broken before her body was dropped at the foot of the stairs to make it look like an accident. The Queen tried a transparent ruse to silence gossip. She sent for all the ambassadors and told them with a smile that while she'd once thought of marrying an Englishman, she now intended to marry a foreign prince. The implication was that they could all go home and try to find suitable suitors for her. For a 16th-century monarch had to have an heir, and a sensible dynastic marriage should also forge a militarily or economically useful alliance. Uneasy indeed lay the head that wore a crown, since it couldn't lie in bed next to the person it most fancied. The ambassadors were not deceived. They were still sure the Queen intended to marry Dudley. One other tricky sounding was made. Sir Henry Sidney, Dudley's brother-in-law, confidentially told the Spanish ambassador that Amy had died in a natural accident. He also hinted that if the Spanish supported a marriage to Dudley, the Queen would re-establish Catholicism in England. A few months later, Dudley put the same proposal to the ambassador. But when the ambassador tried cautiously to revive the suggestion with the pair, the Queen refused to rise to the bait. Elizabeth was, in the end, too good a politician to let her heart rule her head. Marriage under the cloud of the Cumnor scandal would have lost her all respect among the crowned heads of Europe and among her own subjects. Any dissidents who wanted to start a rising in favour of Mary Queen of Scots' claim to England's throne would have had a perfect claim that Elizabeth was unfit to rule. A murderess could not be God's divinely anointed. Was she a murderess? Must good Queen Bess be ranked with wicked women like Madeline Smith and Adelaide Bartlett? Probably not. But there is one very suspicious circumstance. 4 days before Amy's death, Elizabeth told one of the foreign ambassadors that Lady Robert Dudley was very sick and likely to die shortly. In fact, Amy was enjoying rude health. Now, how came the Queen to be such a prophetess? Did Dudley tell her, knowing he was about to have his wife murdered? Possibly. For to this day, we don't know just how Amy Robsart did die. Did she fall, accidentally? Was she pushed? Was she trying to terminate an unexpected, unwanted, and thoroughly unlikely pregnancy, as one writer has suggested? Pretty certainly not. But natural or unnatural death? We don't know. The destruction of the papers was effective. We do know that Dudley's contemporaries later remarked that men whose ladies he fancied had a convenient habit of dying, and it was widely believed that he employed an Italian poisoner to facilitate his love life. But the Queen was too canny to link herself matrimonially with such a man. For all she loved his physique, his arrogance, and an unscrupulousness matching her own, to Dudley's increasing bitterness and chagrin, she steadily put off and put off and put off all question of marriage until it was clear he would never be her consort. She showered him with honours. As Earl of Leicester, he was the very grandest of grandees. But he was never again within reach of the throne. She even tried unsuccessfully to preserve one of our rights, yours and mine, from him. He was given permission to build a house near Westminster on some open fields. But the Queen stipulated that the common people, you and I, must still have the right to dry washing there in perpetuity. Leicester Fields were gradually built over further, and today we know the place as Leicester Square. I love sovereigns who respect my rights, and I long to string up a line between Shakespeare's statue and John Hunter's bust and peg out my socks on it in Leicester Square. After all, I should tell the police, Queen Elizabeth herself said I must be allowed to.
Thank you.